Given the fact that we had this very nice introduction into rhythm before, which took a bit longer, I will try to go faster through it. But if at some point you feel like I should stop and I should explain something more, just tell me. I will sit down, because it's otherwise I will be always somehow in the way for somebody. Okay, so we had the first part of this presentation, which was the rhythm workshop. We saw that rhythm in Turkish music is usually related to usul, at least in composed pieces and in interpretations thereof. So we saw these pieces. Just to remind you, we had a Şarkı, which is a song in a short usul. We had the two instrumental forms of Sassemaise and Peşref. And I will now start a little bit presenting some thoughts on fundamental approaches, on what I think should be important when we try to process rhythm in Turkish music, and some fundamental approaches which I also consider important in order to distinguish the work in this project a little bit from what is usually done or from what has happened until now. One important idea which I think we should follow is a top-down approach, or what I say, it's a top-down top approach, which is considering the music we have as structured into several layers, and keeping in mind and carefully considering all these relations between these layers. So let's say we have at the top layer the musical form. For example, we looked at the Peşref, which is built up of several parts. So this is what I mean when I say musical form. Then we have another layer which is built up from in Turkish music of by using the usuls. So we have rhythmic cycles. Related to that, we have melodic phrases. So I think also in rhythmic analysis, as I show on that slide, we should not forget that we should not always look only where there's something which is a beat, where something hitting our speakers, but it's also considering aspects of the melody when we do all this processing. And on the layers more down, then we would have something like a beat, if we want to call it like that, or a fundamental pulse, which I find a little bit more suitable in this context. Even lower, the onset detection, so then really at the signal layer, where does a note or where does a pulse or however we want to call it start in our music signal. And it would be nice, not, as I said, not to present papers for only for beat tracking in Turkish music, but to somehow relate all these layers with each other and try to improve performance at several layers by combining knowledge from other layers. So this is one fundamental thing which I think would be nice to have it in this work, to consider music more as a whole thing and not as, okay, now we are happy that we can find the onsets and then we go to detect the beat without considering the results of the other parts. The second fundamental thing is, which we can basically apply in the Turkish group, is duality, which is we can take advantage of the fact that we have both a large amount of MIDI data and a large amount of audio data, In the MIDI data, our MIDI data set currently has, I think, 1,700 songs. The nice thing is we can extend this data set according to our needs. And we already have a significant amount of data where we have both MIDI and interpretations of these compositions. So we can construct a nice parallel data set which has MIDI and the performance in audio. And I think this is an important thing which we should take advantage of in this project, that we have this opportunity to look at both sides and maybe even in some signal processing aspects which we can propose then. Maybe this can even help in some way also in Indian music, I don't know. Maybe because we have this additional layer, we can help each other better here because we have this possibility, I don't know. Just some statistics about the distribution of this parallel data we have. I call it parallel. It's not parallel in the sense we don't know exactly where in this audio recording does this measure start, where does this part start, but we have parallel data, that's what I mean. So we have a lot of songs, Sharkes, Peshrev and Sassemaisi, which are the three forms we looked at and which I consider would be also the most useful things to consider in our analysis. This is according to the makam, which is also nice because the most popular makams are at least somehow populated. And according to the usuls, we can say that this overview shows that we will need extension in some specific usuls, but in that we are talking with Kemal in order to obtain, when we say, okay, we need, for example, we would definitely need some more songs which have Semai usul or Sofyan usul, but we can easily achieve that. And the numbers we are talking about here, I think they are not huge. I think it would be sufficient, for example, for usul analysis, that at least we start with a parallel corpus which is equally distributed and has at least something like 40-50 songs in each usul class, and we are not far away from that. And the third point is something Javier maybe does not like. I think the research we are conducting, at least in Turkish music in rhythm, should be comparative. I think we should see first what are the differences to styles in other music. And the second point would be something we all agree on. I think which should be important is that we have an intense discussion. For example, that when we work something out in rhythm in Turkish music, Ajay and me, we started already before this presentation discussing, and I think it would be very good when we when we have a very direct contact to exchange ideas. I think in this sense comparative is meaningful. And I also think that we should not tailor tools for the specific culture. At least not in the sense that we make something which only works for that. I think we should always ask ourselves, how can we apply, what kind of advantage can be the outcome of what we do here? For example, if we do a beat tracking, a pulse tracking or whatever in this form of music, I think it's very interesting also for many forms of Western music where currently approaches fail, to see what is happening there. And also we should say, okay, before we start programming, before we have the crazy idea how we can do the beat tracking in Turkish music, should try how good are actually the things we have, which have been proposed. And also what is not written here, I think comparative, it makes also sense to say, of course, it's good to understand the music we are looking at and then compare. But I saw now in the first work that at first comparing can also lead to some understanding. For example, in terms of syncopation, I did not understand anything before. Then I started measuring and comparing, and then I started understanding and discussing with musicians. And I saw that what I measured and compared, actually it makes sense for them. So I think comparative elements should be important. So the menu. As we have seen in the MIR slides, there are several aspects, and they are all related to these layers. So, and this is also kind of the chronological order I would see for rhythm research in Turkish music. So it's kind of starting at an upper layer with segmentation. It goes over usul recognition, a fundamental pulse recognition, then a detection of ornamentations, which is some interesting application on the level of onset detection. Then it goes back the levels up and would try to do some usul tracking, so not a beat tracking, but an usul tracking or annotation. And then a recognition. So I will just go quickly, or I will at least try to go quickly through these points. The first thing has already started basically with Sertan's work. So where we actually now do some matching of a score and a performance. I think this approach has to be used, and we have to see how does it actually perform when we take the bigger parallel data set. What is happening there? What are the problems? What are the good things? And also how does it actually compare when we try to use some segmentation approach for Western music? What does this give on this music? Maybe it's, we don't know, I think. And then what you've been programming, then when we optimize it, it would be nice to see what happens when we try to use a cover song detection or whatever, some Western task. I mean, what, for example, these matrix approaches, the image processing approaches which you include. Yeah, so. Yeah. So we should check that. So, and we should also extend it towards what is actually happening when we use these things, then these similarity matrix things and these image processing things. What is happening when we don't try to align a score with audio? But what can happen? I mean, what can we do when we want to structure the audio itself without having the score? So, yeah, and usul recognition. Okay, I can skip that, I guess, because we saw that there are several forms of usul, and there's the velveleli form and the simple form. We saw that in the introduction in the beginning. And also there's some starting work now. I think I started now doing this work on the symbolic data. And a first step was to see the compositions and how far do they, in which form can we see the usul when looking at the notes of this melody? I mean, is there some correlation in various aspects? And possible aspects are, where are the onsets? Where does a note start? possible aspects are, where are the long notes? Maybe long notes are there where strong beats are. Other aspects are, for example, inter-onset interval histograms. And for example, you can see these two things here. This is the theory. So this is an Ossul as we would have it in theory. So that was what has actually been played before. This is an exact Ossul. So this is düm tekke düm tek tek düm tekke düm tek. Anyway, okay, sorry. But this describes somehow the weights we encounter in the rhythmic cycle of this Aksak Ossul. And this is using a larger set of composition in that Ossul. And looking where are the durations, how long are the durations at these specific parts of the Ossul. And you can see that, for example, the strong intonations coincide at least with long notes. And the same holds for onset locations. So we have kind of strong, more notes appear where I have a high weight given by the Ossul. So there are things, but what I found is that they are not as strong as they would be in Western music, for example. And metrical contradiction, I don't know, no, I have, yeah. So metrical contradiction is a term which we usually say syncopation. So I have a meter which gives me some weights, and my composition does something different at some parts. And the question is that also of systematic importance of the Ossul, yes or no? Before I started that analysis, we found no mentioning of syncopation in literature. When speaking with Turkish people about syncopation, the answer was like, what is syncopation? But then I measured and I saw that there is systematic appearance. And now when talking, for example, today again in the demonstration, again, there was the word syncopation was used, but in a different way than for Western music. So just one example maybe for syncopation. You have this score of the Kürdili Hicaskyar Peshrev. There you have somewhere a little bit down from the middle, you have a line where in the middle it says second Hane. So I already marked some contradictions for you where there's actually a pause where there's a strong beat. So I just give you this as an acoustic example. See? So these are the two measures which I also wrote the düm tekke below. You see, okay, there's some onset missing. The nice thing is, okay, we have a beat there. There's the percussion instrument playing. So we can say that's fine, we can handle that. But let's listen to the same example in a different interpretation. So the strong beat, there's nothing. And this is characteristic. This is not a random characteristic of this composition. This is again a Duyek Ossul, which was just mentioned by our specialist as a syncopated Ossul. So something is going on here. Mm-hmm.
Immediate answer is we have syncopation everywhere. And what do you mean by syncopation? That is the changing of the strong beats and weak beats. So he would say in this diegetsu, the strong beats and weak beat changes place. Mm-hmm. That he would name a syncopation. But
I believe in Indian music, syncopation does not exist.
But
do you call it syncopation?
We don't call it syncopation.
We don't call it as a concept, but as a thing.
There's actually a Tamil word for it. They say Sholu Kota
Vashikar. There is a North Indian word also. We call Aditar.
Aditar, yes. So today I'll actually show an example wherein it's totally off beat and then it becomes really, really hard to actually count it.
What I want to say is they don't give this kind of an example, for example. Here, Andre's example,
yes.
Where you expect to see a strong beat, and it's defined in the usu, and you don't see it. They don't talk about that. They talk about, in the definition of the usu, you have the different location of strong and weak beats. That's what they would think at first instance when you talk about something.
So they talk about a syncopation as part of the metrical definition.
Yes.
So this is really weird for a Western understanding.
Right. Yes. And we should ask, maybe tomorrow we should ask about your example, then how would you define that example? That you don't have any event where you expect it strongly.
See, in most odd rhythms, you have syncopation almost by default. Because syncopation by definition is disturbance of accents. Mm-hmm. So whenever you have that sort of an odd metrical structure, you're going to end up with something that sounds syncopated anyway, in addition to what you might do intentionally to displace the accent.
Yeah, but there are things like, from what I think is there are some usuls which are referred to as being syncopated by themselves. Yeah. And then again, on top of that, there is syncopation in reference to that usul.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is.
Yeah, okay.
Just by definition, because of the uneven structure.
Uh-huh.
And on top of that, what you intentionally do for expression, mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You displace.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I mean, so there are all these things, and there are some first results now in how far these aspects are important. So these are first implications then where later audio processing should start. What should it consider? Okay, the next thing is the fundamental pulse. So I don't call it a beat. And the question is, do Turks beat it? So it's a similar thing to beat tracking in Western music, but is there a beat? Do they actually tap to a regular pulse? When you observed our percussion player, he played the usuls, but he did not tap anything. There is a regular pulse, but he did not move his foot or something to that. And the next question is, I mean, when we ask Turkish people, for example, to tap, would they agree in that? I mean, is there a... would that make any sense to them? So I mean, that would be something which is a bit out of the focus of the project. But related to that, also expert interviews would be of interest. What can be done is, and what will actually be done, hopefully in the Izmir conference, is a tapping experiment where we will set up a tapping station, that's what we call it, and put some Turkish music and ask listeners to actually tap a beat. And we plan to do that both with Turkish and non-Turkish listeners to see what is actually happening, how do people perceive a beat. And I just had the opportunity to submit a nice journal with exactly that focus for African music, and the results were mind-blowing. It was really interesting what happened there. When you make Western people tap to African music, there are things happening the most interesting thing which we observed was people agree in tempo, so they tap some stable tempo, but the phase alignment is random. So it's completely, they get the tempo, but the alignment is anywhere. Okay, I mean, these kind of things are very interesting also, I think, and very important to address here.
And did you test it with local listeners?
No, that was actually, it was a cooperation with Olmo Cornelis, and they did it in Belgium with Music Academy students. So it's only Western listeners doing that. Okay, so these are first questions related to that, and then the next question is, of course, do our algorithms beat it? So when we use the state of the art we have right now, what is happening when we use Turkish music? Do we get anything meaningful? Do we get anything that is consistent with what people tapped or not? So we can, for example, use a set of these annotations or annotate pieces ourselves, and we can measure how well do our algorithms agree with these taps. And can we then include any knowledge we have about from the previous step about onset distributions in order to improve maybe algorithms for beat tracking? What else? We have some interesting tools for that, actually, to compare also a large set of beat trackers or annotators to see where do they agree and how do they agree. And I think these kind of measurements can be very helpful there to really get a picture of human tapping performance and algorithmic tapping performance and finding a connection between them. So now we, the elevator reached the ground floor, and we are on the onset detection level. So I think in terms of onset detection, in terms of the signal characteristics, it's not really something useful to spend a lot of time on that, because basically the signal characteristics do not significantly change for most instruments. But the playing style, as we said in the fundamental frequency session, the playing style differs. And this we have seen in previous publications, that exactly this playing style also affects the onset detection and its accuracy. I have a short example of an oud, where you see a characteristic chapma, which is an ornamentation, which are onsets, but onsets which you would not have in any Western form or playing style. At the end, this tapping, you would not. This is very characteristic. A very characteristic chartma for oud playing in Turkey, and no Western now would play in his style his instrument like that. He would be thrown out of the orchestra, I think. So, it would be interesting then to use this dual method to get some alignment between the onsets existent in a score and those detected in audio. It would be important then also to take into account several aspects of the signal. So you can easily track onsets of an oud using spectral flux, but you will not find anything when you have a nay. And the interesting thing will be then to detect areas where actually the onset detection is very different in the audio from what we would expect in the score. You can listen to this example where we have one part where we have more onsets than the score and one part where we have significantly less. And this is very interesting to focus maybe on these parts because they express very small deviations in time from the score, which are very important for the playing style. So in the second part we again had a chapma on Do, on the C note, and here he rather slided down and did not reproduce all the notes which are shown in the score. And I think these parts, they are, in terms of playing style, they are very interesting to detect and to say what is happening there. Maybe we can this way also build up some kind of an alphabet of interesting chapmas and ornamentations. So questions here are, which of those over detections or under detections are related to ornamentations, and what kind of ornamentations do exist? What do we have? Can we classify them? Are there specific classes? And where do they appear? Do they appear at specific parts of the meter? Are there instrument specific ornamentations? Can we detect them? And the risky task is, of course, can we remove them? I mean, can we automatically recognize the spirit of the melody behind these ornamentations? But this is, of course, science fiction. Okay, for the usul recognition, you saw that slide or this picture before. We have periodicity descriptors. And we have seen in terms of usuls that they capture something. We did some work on that. But as I said, they lose some kind of some amount of information. And as we saw in the demonstration, the sequential order is important. It's not only about periodicities, which are somewhere in the signal. But it's not that somewhere, but it's the sequential order of an usul which is important. An usul which goes 3 to 2 is different from one which goes 2 to 3. So we would like, I think it would be interesting to have sequential descriptors for that which take into account this order. So I will just go to the next slide then. When we proceeded through all that, it would be a musically more intuitive thing than not to only annotate a pulse, but to annotate the actual usul. Let's say we succeed in tracking a pulse, then it would be nice to decide which of these pulses belong to which part of the usul. So for example, if I have some pulse, it would be nice if I have the labeling into dum, tek, tek, dum, tek. So I know which is a dum and which is a tek. That would make much more sense for the musicians and would help us also in computational understanding of that music a lot. I think there's this differentiation between annotation and tracking. I think an usul tracking is not really of increased value for us, because I don't think we will attempt to propose some automatic accompaniment system for oud players or whatever. I think that's and anyway, if we would, it would be more useful to make the usul accompaniment fixed and force the player to react to it. So but then when we try to understand where in a recording is which element of the usul, we have various kind of difficulties. It's easy, for example. Okay, that's rather cheesy and easy. So here it's not difficult to get an understanding of the meter because we have even have drums. Okay, but that's not the rule. Because especially in older recordings, percussion is less common. It's an interesting development that nowadays they even drums are used in the productions, while old recordings are more likely to sound that. This is, I think, the same song even, or well, I don't know. So that's what we want to get out of that signal. That would be a useful thing. So we have a wide variety of signals here, and but this task would be really meaningful. So, okay, we have various levels of difficulties, so we can have a percussive accompaniment. There things are basically more easy. Okay, maybe I also skip a little bit the details here. But there we can do something quite easily. If we have only melodic instrument, it gets more difficult. We can, if we find some fundamental pulse, as I said, maybe we are also on somehow on a safe way, but if not, then we really go somewhere else. So, and we are back at the very first slide basically with that. So we basically arrived at music, which has maybe some form of meter, maybe not meter in the Western sense, but it has no obvious pulse. And this is, okay, this has not been approached, but there we go into a very interesting area. And I think we have to do other things than just trying to find periodicities where there are none. So we have to, what I said, we have to consider information from the other levels, like where are onsets on the low level, or where we can maybe detect phrase boundaries on a higher level in order to get the information in the middle.
Of?
Yes, do I have an example here? Wait. Yes, I have. So this has an usul, this has a pulse, but it is at some points it even it makes more the impression of a taksim if you don't know the music. It sounds free a bit. So this is hard, but this is the same composition, I think. Is it the same one? So that's the way it goes. I mean, we have some cases where for the same piece we can track it, I think. But there are some cases like that which make our life very difficult then. Okay, so just some conclusions, I think. Apart from publishing stuff, it would be nice if we can think of a way to include all that also into the browsing system. So that's why I asked also about how to include a score, because ideally you would have at some point for Turkish music at least a browser where you have an audio recording and you have an aligned score and you can study that by saying, okay, I want to study that part of the score and you automatically have the aligned audio, and you have a very smart understanding of both automatically. So if throughout the years we can propose at least some of these for some of these tasks, some methods, and we can include it in such a browser, then it's really something useful, because studying Turkish music at a computer is currently not very comfortable. So that would be really nice, because we have the symbolic representations and we have a lot of recordings, but we have no way to access it and to use it practically. And just two remarks on my personal goals. And the thing is, I ask myself, how do fit Usul in our common understanding of meter? Or how does maybe common understanding of meter in Western music, how do we have to widen the focus to say, okay, Usul fits in there? Or how does it relate to that? And is there actually something like this nice hierarchical structure? I mean, there is a hierarchy. There's something like a stronger beat and a weaker beat. But how does that look? How can that be modeled? That's my personal motivation of all the things, basically. Okay.